Welcome everybody to the final episode of F4 Fringe Power, radio in support of the Fundy Fringe Festival on local 107.3 FM. But wait, didn't the Fundy Fringe Festival end last week, you say? Well, prepare yourselves for what we call F4 Fringe Power Aftermath. We touch base with some of the 2016 Fundy Fringe Festival participants to see what their experience was like during this St. John Theatre Festival. And we'll also be talking a little bit about the upcoming Fundy Fringe event, Best of the Fest, which features some of our favorite shows this season. Thank you for joining us. You are in bed with Tim Turnell. I am Tim Turnell, and for our final episode, we have pulled out the stops once again, and my oversight Chad has come through, like I made sure he would. He's got me a waterbed. Yep, over the last week, while I was out, the two Seans came in and installed my waterbed while I was gone. Yes, I have a bed frame and a membrane. The water baggy Philly thing is empty. It's just lying here unfilled. Kind of like my life. Thank you, Chad. Thank you, Oversight. Thank you very much. You did a great, great job. Now I have an episode that is happening after the Fringe Festival has already finished, and I have a waterbed that has no water. Thank you very much, Oversight. Thank you, Chad. I'm a little tired. This past week, during the Fundy Fringe Festival, I, myself, as Theater Narcissus 12, performed a performance art marathon in support of the Fundy Fringe Festival and to raise awareness. One second. Hello, Oversight. So, folks, do yourself a favor. Get a head start on next year, the 2017 Fundy Fringe Festival. Go online and look up www.fundyfringefestival.com. There you will find all the information you need to apply yourself. Because I know you have a show that you're either looking to shop around to new fringe festivals, or a show that you have still inside you that you want to get out. This is a perfect venue. You can also follow them on Twitter at Fundy Fringe Fest, and, of course, Facebook and Instagram. But don't just take my word for it. I am at the Mary Olin Theatre in the New Brunswick Museum, one of our Fundy Fringe Festival venues for the 2016 season. And I have to invade the space, the rehearsal warm-up time, for the Dead Sheep Scrolls final show.
Changing our name.
And I know. And I. Hello, boys. Hello. Hello, lady. Way over there. I see. It's all been separated. I apologize for having to invade your space, but I really, really wanted to talk to you before you left. I know it's a very tight schedule as you are getting ready to open for your final show. I just want to wish you all the best. Thank you again. How great it's been to see you in the fourth season.
Fourth time out.
Yeah,
fourth
and out. Also, once again, from the bottom of my heart, thank you for being the King Street Climbing Association.
Yeah.
Right. So, everyone's sore? Yes. Still sore? Yes. You got going to be on the heel?
The bruises are starting to show up on my ribs.
Barely made it.
Yeah, I'm seeing a lot of flesh right now. Like, oh, you have a scar right there.
You've got bruises up under here.
That was amazing, but you know what? That was dead.
I'm not showing you mine. No,
I get that. Now. So I just wanted to know what keeps making you apply to the Fundy Fringe Festival.
Well, I'd say we feel like a part of the Fringe family here by now. And that I wouldn't miss it.
No, the people. We just got into that about 2 years ago. After our second year, we said, if we don't get in, we're just going to come anyway.
Yeah.
And just be here for, you know, seeing everybody and being involved with everything. And we'll actually get to see more shows if we're not doing one. So You kind of hope for that.
Beautiful
one
sense of community in this fringe.
And that's funny because when I was walking here to see you, that is exactly what I was thinking. Those exact words, because between the Dead Sheep Scrolls and say maybe even Red Necklace Productions, you guys are the epitome. You are the badge. You are the icon of community. Fringe as community, you know what I'm saying? Because I love seeing you guys. So what happens if you don't get selected next year? What's going to happen?
We'll just have to come up and see the shows anyway.
We buy tickets.
We'll just have to buy passes.
Yeah.
Yep. Come for Fringe.
Absolutely.
Four road passes. Trip.
Yeah.
That'd be wonderful because we love seeing you. Now you're going back, passing out the mustaches. That's great.
Maybe we'll find some kind of performance art piece to do that week or something.
Maybe
somewhere.
Yeah, sure we can create something. That would be great.
We'll work on our flash mobs more. Maybe we'll probably get more buzz on a year that we're not actually performing because we'll be out and about doing different kind of street performances and things.
You're going to be busy all year round though when you get back to Wolfville, right?
We sure are.
What do you do?
I'm a teacher, an eighth grade teacher, so I'm heading back to school tomorrow.
So you're always performing, basically.
I am always on stage.
Okay.
I'm a theater technician and a musician and an actor. And yeah, it's just about everything in the arts.
Okay, so you're on the dole, just like me.
A little bit of everything.
Yeah, a little bit good.
To try and keep it together, yeah.
Ross, what about you? What are you gonna be doing when you get back?
I'm picking up my job at the university there at Acadia, where I do a lot of IT stuff,
mm-hmm.
and then just continuing on with what we do, sort of the extracurriculars, which sadly, Jamie's professionals are my extracurriculars.
Oh, okay.
I come on, I volunteer, and he's always kicking me for that because people always say, "Oh, what can we pay you guys?" I said, "Oh no, it's all free." James like, "No, give us money." I always forget to ask to get paid.
Okay, Alan, what about you?
I'll be starting up work for the Annapolis Valley Music Festival, getting their syllabus put together and so on. And in about 2 weeks, the group of us we start up our Night Kitchen,
yes,
our new season, which is really exciting.
Yeah, that takes up a lot of your time in Wolfville, doesn't it? The Night Kitchen. Good. And Dead Sheep Scrolls itself does their own performances throughout the year still?
It's nice because in hosting the show now, we used to get invited out to be in the show, but now that we host it, we have even more carte blanche than we had before. And then we're going to take the show that we're doing here, and what we like to do is we have kind of the homecoming. So we bring it to Fringe to refine it and make it perfect, and then we take it home and we perform it for our friends.
Okay.
And it's kind of like, we always thought of it as our...
No, you haven't done this show pigeonholed. You haven't done this show for your hometown yet.
No. This was our first performance of it here.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, wow.
We perfect it here and then we take it home.
World premiere at the Fundy Fringe. Where's my wine?
That's been the case every year. Every year we've brought a show here. We performed it first here and then brought it home. And
how does how do the homebodies appreciate it? What's the response you're getting?
They love it.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, we have a very supportive community back in Wolfville.
Yeah.
Well, folks, I want to wish you all the best again. Have a safe travel. I'll eat a burger or two for you over at the Fundy Fringe after barbecue. And I will hopefully see you guys again next year. So, all the best with tonight's show.
We're coming
Thank
here, too.
Thank you.
Almost always welcome to invade our space.
It's on the planet.
I will. Oh, jeez.
So, yeah, basically, we're just on Princess Street, right across from the Hey Paul Jukebox installation piece, which is successfully still operating at this hour on the final day of the Fundy Fringe Festival. And right down a couple doors is the Hub. I'm with Donovan Jackson.
Hello.
Hey, I did pronounce that right.
Yes, you did.
Donovan Jackson. Great. How was Alta Vista?
It was fantastic, you know. People that came were really engaged. They laughed, they enjoyed themselves, and they danced. Yes, that's right. I had audience participation, that awful word. And people danced and got jiggy, and it was great.
Good. So what prompted you to come back to the Fundy Fringe Festival? Did you have a good time last year?
Yes, last year was a great experience. I found that because it is a smaller festival, you're able to get to know everyone a little bit better, and it becomes a little bit more like summer camp, you know, opposed to Winnipeg, I was just in July, where it's very easy to get lost in the crowd, and it's definitely more competitive to get attention and to get reviews, and it's all about, you know, cutthroat. But here it's laid back, it's easy, and it's fun.
Mm-hmm. Do people that may have come to your show this year, did any of them remember you from last year?
Yes, a lot of the volunteers actually said that, like, oh, your face looks familiar. I just can't put it. Do you work at the Imperial? And I'm like, no.
Okay, good.
And then I had some audience members saying that they remembered the work that I did last year, and it was very interesting, and that's what prompted them to come see me this year.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
So what's next for you after this?
Directly after this, I have 2 weeks just kind of bumming around, cleaning up around the apartment. And then I'm doing a dance theater version of The Little Mermaid with Ismailova Theater of Dance in Toronto.
Oh.
Yeah, so we start rehearsals right in the middle of September, and that's presented in October, right at the beginning.
How do you dance with the Finn costume?
I'll find out.
Oh, he's really hurt.
And can we hope to see you again in the future at another Fringe Festival?
Oh, yes. There will be a future, and I will be there. And yeah. So will you.
I will be. I'm not going anywhere either. Yeah. Thank you, Donovan Jackson. Appreciate your time, and best wishes for the rest of your journey.
Thank you. You as well.
Everyone, this is a part of the whole Fringe Power series that you've been waiting for. I am with Paul Parley, a.k.a. Hey Paul Jukebox. How you doing, Paul?
Good.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for participating in this art installation project. If people aren't aware, what we did was we put a music list up in the public traffic area.
I see, sure.
Yeah, and so they could look at the plaque.
Yes.
That had all these lists,
yes.
And they shout at you, right?
Yes.
They shout at you, they give you a disc and a track number, and then you're happy to play it.
That's right,
yeah.
And I was.
Yeah, and you were, and yeah. People got really, really into it. I remember being here helping close the hub during one of the evening events, and people were outside going, oh, is Paul awake? Oh, is Paul awake?
I thought I heard them in my dream.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
So what was your favorite part about the whole thing? Did you have a favorite part, or was it really tough work?
No, it was fun. I just enjoyed meeting people like that.
Yeah?
It's fun, yeah.
Yeah, you meet people. They scream up. You're what?
Sure.
You're three stories up.
Yeah.
You're on the third story of that building there.
And the girls were saying, oh, where's Paul? There he is. Put this on and that on. I just said, yeah, I love it. And love yous.
Yeah. Did you ever get tired? Do you ever just want to sleep?
And no.
No? They were all good to you?
Just at certain times at night. Late.
So people were good to you, though?
Yes, very well.
Oh, yes. Good. What were the most popular songs? Was there one that you had to play over and over and over again,
Oh, yes. Smooth Off Criminal
by
Michael Jackson.
Nice.
And a couple Beyoncés
were on there. Sure, that's true. That's true.
And anything that they really like was good enough for me. I like it all.
Well, that's nice.
And I do too, right?
So do you think it was really weird at first, you know? Like, I came up to you and I said, hey, you know that music you play all week long, and everyone's like, who's that guy? Who's that guy? You know, and then I come up to you and ask, hey, do you want to just do something so people can ask for requests?
I liked it. Yes,
did you?
At the time. Sure, I like it.
I thought maybe, like, I know you said yes when I first approached you, and then a couple weeks later when we were getting closer to Fringe, and you kind of were like, I don't know. Then I had to kind of go, hey, romance-y a little bit, you know, go, what do you think? So it was a good experience for you after all, right?
Yeah, because I'm just not used to, never did that before, right?
Yeah. Do you meet a lot of artsy people or theater people that would be coming in and out?
I did. Lots of nice people, yeah.
Yeah, not too weird?
No, not
too stuffy?
No, I never found nobody bad.
No, they're really encouraging, eh?
Courage, I like it. I met a lot of different people coming in the last 5 or 6 days.
So now that the Fringe is over,
mm-hmm.
say next month,
yes.
September 12th or something like that, right?
Yeah.
Someone's walking down the road, you're hanging out,
you
know, in your room there,
yeah.
And someone screams, hey, Paul! Mm-hmm. Would you play them a tune still?
I will,
yeah. And you do it next year, you think?
I would,
you think you'll do it next year?
I hope so, yeah.
Cool. Well, Paul, thanks again. I know people really, really enjoyed this. I know you may not have been able to hear because you're up in the room a lot of the times. People, you might not have been able to hear, but I'll tell you right now, I was very, very aware that the folks that were in and out of the hub here on Princess Street really appreciated what you did.
And
And they really enjoyed it.
That's good.
You made a big difference on this block during this week. So,
I hope so.
Yeah, you were a star. Thanks a lot.
I know, the girls were telling me, they were hauling up saying, you're good, you're a star.
Oh, I love you.
I said, good. I know, I'm trying.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, thanks again, Paul. Yeah. That's Hey Paul Jukebox.
Hey Paul Jukebox and rock on St. John and keep moving on.
That's right.
Love y'all.
Now, Ryland, how was your experience during the Fundy Fringe Festival?
It was absolutely amazing.
Really? You can be serious with me now.
I am 100%. I had a fantastic time. I met so many cool people, and all the audiences that came to the show seemed to really, really enjoy it, which was a nice feeling. I had a lot of good comments after. I had people come back for repeat shows, which I think is a testament that they did truly enjoy it.
I was here during the first show. Everyone was coming out because I wanted to say hi and welcome you on your first day. And I think yours was, from my limited experience, because I'm usually too busy, but you had probably the largest audience I'd ever seen on an opening.
Really?
Yeah, from my limited experience. Yeah. But no, I think I'm pretty solid in saying that you probably had the most successful opening I've been aware of, and the reviews were just incredible. People really, really were impressed by what you did. Did anything really concern you about, you know, how the rest of the week would go for you? Because this Fringe collided with a lot of art stuff. There was a lot of competition in the city.
Well, when I came in, I mean, I didn't know at all what to expect. You know, this being my first Fringe Festival anywhere, and so when I had the tease night, I think I had a good response, which probably, you know, equated to people coming out for the shows over the week. And that first night, it was really great, and I was thinking like, okay, this is only like the Wednesday night. I bet you like, you know, Thursday, Friday, Saturday night, like it's going to be even more. You know, and it was more the opposite, actually. It's the Thursday night was our big crowd, and then the Sunday afternoon as well was the biggest crowd we had.
You had even bigger crowds than the first night.
On the Sunday afternoon, which was the last show. But like the Friday night, Saturday night, it was, I think we had about, I'm going to say 25 to 30 kind of each night, which wasn't as many as the first or the last. And I thought that was kind of weird because it's a Friday, Saturday, and if I'm, you know, going to go out on a date or something with someone, I go out then. But then we walked around downtown and we realized there was like a gallery art hop. There was a ton of stuff. Yeah. So people were there. And then the Saturday night, the Tragically Hip concert was going on. So there was so many other things, which kind of makes sense. You know, people are going to pick and choose. But overall, I was happy with it, and I'm glad that people did come out, you know, because it's no fun doing magic to, you know, four or five people in a place that seats, you know, 50, so.
Yeah, and it's true. It was a very exciting time in the city for audiences because there was so much going on. But it was risky for performers, but it sounds like you did really well. I mean, 30 and 40 for someone who isn't local, you know, I mean, because your local shows are definitely going to get, you know,
yeah,
filled
people
up.
People know, yeah.
And it's a young festival still. We're growing, and we're really happy to have people such as yourself coming. So, are you gonna try another Fringe Festival somewhere else in the world?
I think so. I think I'll definitely look into them more. I mean, I don't know where yet or when, and you know, like it's all luck of the draw. But I'll put my name in, I think, at you know, some other Fringe Festivals and kind of see what happens. I really enjoyed the atmosphere. I enjoyed the people, and I really enjoyed being like in a theater environment, which a lot of times is hard for a magician that isn't, like, you know, well known. If you're, you know, on TV and, you know, you're a big celebrity kind of magician, or, you know, you have big illusions, okay, they're in theaters. But a lot of times people equate magic to, like, you know, children's parties and, you know, small time kind of little events. And that's not really what my kind of show is about. And so being able to, you know, do it in a theater environment, we used a video screen and some video technology, which was fantastic. You know, we had the lighting, we had, you know, voiceovers, the whole thing. So that's what's nice. And so if I could do more Fringes, you know, with that style in like, you know, studio theater or whatever, I'd love to do that.
Would you come back to the Fundy Fringe?
I would definitely come back, you know.
Because you've got connections here now.
Yeah, I know some people here now, and I'm doing Fredericton exhibition in a couple of weeks. So I know some of the volunteers are going to come up to see some shows at the Fredericton exhibition, which will be nice. But I'd love to come back to the Fundy Fringe. I was talking to a few people, maybe even coming in and doing some shows kind of in a different time of the year here at the theater, and, you know, making it kind of an event when things aren't going on as much. So
more opportunities are coming toward you.
Exactly. Yeah.
Good.
So we'll see what happens. But, you know, I definitely, if worse comes to worse, you know, and I don't get back ASAP, you know, I'll be back for sure sometime in the future.
Great. Well, if someone was listening right now who is in the situation you may have been just before you applied to the Fundy Fringe, you're kind of deciding, you've never done a Fringe before. What would your advice be to them to do it? Like, what would you say to encourage someone to
I think the biggest thing is you have to come in with the idea that you're not doing it for a specific reason. You know, you're doing it to get an overall sense of, you know, what your show is, what works, you know, how to market your show, how to, you know, deal with a tight schedule because you only have, you know, 15 minutes of setup, 15 minutes of teardown. Mm-hmm. So you're doing it sort of the overall learning experience, you know, the overall value. So then when you come out of it, I mean, after 5 days of doing my show, I feel like I'm a lot more prepared, you know, to go into any environment and really do well with it.
So definitely jump in.
Yeah, jump, like jump head in. Like, don't be, you know, you don't want to be like, well, I don't think I'm ready, or I, you know, I don't know about this, or I don't know about that, or I don't know how, you know, many tickets I'm going to sell or whatever. It shouldn't be about that. It should be like, you know, come in, use it as an experience, learn from it, enjoy it, have fun with it. Everyone's so nice. And then, you know, you'll walk away and you'll have a great feeling.
Great. Well, Rylan, can I call you Rylan?
Yeah.
Rylan, Rynestone Schwarze, thank you very much. And all the best in the rest of your career. And we'll hope to see you again soon.
Thank you so much, Tim.
Thank you. We're just outside of the O Room, the St. John Ale House, which was one of our venues here during the 2016 Fundy Fringe season. Right down in good old Market Square. We have Andrew Wetmore once again back on the show.
Hello.
Hey, thanks for coming. And it's actually quite a nice day. The fountain's going, so I apologize to the audience out there.
No, but that's fine. We're actually sitting in the fountain, and you know, because you get sort of sweaty doing all the shows, and it's nice to wash everything off again.
It's nice on the toes. So, Andrew, how was your experience during the Fundy Fringe?
Well, many, many positives. I got to work in the Mary Oland Theatre inside the New Brunswick Museum, which is a real honest-to-God theater with seats that are fixed to the floor
right
and air conditioning
the,
and all that.
Right across from us here.
Yeah, exactly. There were some really interesting technological disasters.
Oh.
My show had both music and visual effects, a slideshow,
mm-hmm.
and we couldn't make either of them work with the technology in the theater. That is, both my computers could see that there was a projector, but mm-hmm. the projector could not see the computers and couldn't project any slides. And this, everything worked fine at the tech rehearsal, and then we got to the ready to go show, nothing working. And I said, well, I said several things, but the polite form was, never you mind, let's do it without either special effect. So I just went on and told stories, and it worked great. And this was a big learning to me. If you think of the play as a pig, I put lipstick on the pig with mm-hmm. the slideshow and the music. Didn't need it. I took the lipstick off. It's still a good pig.
Oh, well, that's a wonderful discovery.
Yeah.
I think there's been a few I've heard from people just making discoveries as they're running through their project and finding new things here and there. So you had a lot of multimedia. That's kind of different than what I figured from such a period piece. I mean, Lester Beeler would not have a slideshow behind him while he was recanting stories, right?
No, of course that's true. But I think that reveals a certain insecurity I had about the strength of the play. And when I put it together with the author and the company, I thought, I sold it as, wouldn't it be cool if we added some pictures of Lester and his family and things related to the stories? And actually, people got excited about that, and it's worked pretty well when we do it that way. But being forced to do it without the special effects shows me that I should trust the script more. The script is good. As often happens at the high points in the story, when things dramatic things happen, I heard people gasp, draw breath, say "oh no" under their breaths to each other.
Mm-hmm.
So it was very gratifying, and I also didn't have to worry about, am I saying the line right, so the technical person will know the cue mm-hmm. to change to the next slide. So I was a little bit more freeform than I might otherwise have been.
So a growing experience as a performer for the production itself, one of the benefits of doing a Fringe Festival.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. So I'm taking this to the Atlantic Fringe Festival in Halifax.
Good.
And I'm going to bag the music altogether. I'm going to get rid of the audio. We may or may not do the slideshow, depending on how the space is that I'm going to be working in. I've never been in the theater that I'm using there.
Mm-hmm.
But now I don't care. If I have it or don't have it, it's still going to be a good show.
Let's just at least hope that you have air conditioning like you did here.
I doubt I will. You were
the only one that had air conditioning.
Well, there were three other companies. Come on, we all... Sarah Hagen, the pianist, the best pianist I've ever seen tell jokes.
Yes, it's probably the best pianist I've ever seen tell jokes as well.
Yeah, and Pigeonholed and the Velvet Undergrad. We all had the benefit of air conditioning. And really good for the Velvet Undergrad, because as you know, we spent the first 15 minutes underneath a blanket.
Yes, that's true. Poor guy. Neil Bonner, I've heard great things about his show. Well, No Brag Just Facts is going to be at the Atlantic Fringe Festival. That's like in a week or so.
It is. It starts on the... I have to be there on the 1st. Technical rehearsal and the gala opening on the 2nd of September. And then I have shows from the 3rd to the 10th. And then I go home and collapse on the 11th.
Congratulations. So what are you going to do during that downtime between here and there?
Well, I have children and grandchildren at our cottage over by Digby. And I think I might reintroduce myself to them. They haven't seen me for a little while.
I know. I get the feeling that that a lot of people will be doing that too. Well, congratulations. Yeah. Thank you for coming to the Fundy Fringe Festival. Thank you for talking with me.
Sure. And it's a great honor on both levels to talk with you and to take part in the Fringe. This is a cool organization. Anybody who missed out on shows this year has got to be kicking themselves.
Yeah.
And they should start planning their lives for next year.
I do that every year. Kick myself.
Well, there we go. We can have others line up to help.
Oh, yes. Wouldn't that be a great community event? Kick me for all the things I've done wrong. Are we going to see you again?
Oh, I sure hope so.
Yeah?
I'm going to be working on a play for the Script Happens thing.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be working up another play to submit to the Fringe next year.
Wonderful. Well, thanks again, Andrew Wetmore of No Brag, Just Facts.
Thank you.
Thank you. Walking with Watson Osher must be really, really interesting. Well, I'm here again with Donovan Jackson, and I'm with Sarah Rankin, the director of the Fundy Fringe Festival, and of course, faithful, good old potato chip eating Watson, leaving the barbecue, the wrap up of the Fundy Fringe, and it's kind of symbolic. We're walking home.
Walking.
It's all done.
It's all she wrote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Donovan, we talked earlier, but how did the second year really differ from the first year for you?
I felt that there was a lot more activity and a lot more interest, and people just know about it a lot more, so a little bit more hyped up about what's going on, instead of being like, what, the French Festival? No, yeah. No, Fringe!
The French Festival, we get that a lot.
I still get Fridge Festivals.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, somebody asked me that one time, like, a fridge festival, what's that? And I said, well, it's a fringe, but we do have fridges. They're normally filled with beer, but yeah, sure.
And sometimes they do have some French in them.
Yes.
Not in the fridges, but I mean, we've had some bilingual shows.
Yeah, we had a bilingual show this year with Claws, which was really, really cool. It's kid-friendly theater, bilingual, very little Einstein. I loved it.
And French performers, and stuff like that, but... Donovan, you had a different type of show this year, too. Do you find a better reception for a show that's more family-friendly versus the one that you had last year?
No, it's just a different take on what I do. I'm trying to develop my own personal aesthetic, and because I had people who remembered me from last year hoping to see something very similar, and they were very happy to see something similar, just in a different light, you know? Instead of being very introspective and dramatic, it's just now funny and light.
And Watson, I take it's just going to go home and stay in the house while we go out and drink beer, right?
One can only hope.
So, Sarah, Fundy Fringe 2016, come and gone. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Woo! Fundy Fringe 2017, yes. What do you think needs to be the same, and what do you think needs to change?
I think what needs to stay the same is the... number of shows that we have. I think we've got a good number. We're a small fringe by comparison to the big ones. But I think it's the right size for St. John. And I think it's the right size for New Brunswick. I often hear people telling me, you have so much going on, this is crazy. But then I think of places like Winnipeg and Edmonton that have thousands upon thousands of shows, and I'm just like, okay, this is all you can handle for now. So that'll probably stay the same. After hours events, I think, will stay the same pretty much. They're very successful.
They were very good this year.
Yeah. Right. What will change? Hopefully what will change is, you know, how we promote the festival and how we get word out. Hopefully we'll have some more dineros next year to really produce more and bigger print materials that will capture the attention and get people's eyes on the festival.
Yeah, because you don't really have a problem with numbers of applications.
No, we have no issues there. That's the heartbreaking part for me, is that we have so few slots, but we get so many applications.
I guess, really it's just going to be the ongoing struggle, as it probably always will be, to make sure that people become more and more aware of the Fringe Festival and come out and fill seats. Even though it was really a very active weekend, well, the whole week was filled with a lot of conflicts. There were a lot of things going on. So, do you think the numbers were up or down?
You know, it's hard to tell at this point in the game. There were nights that felt really, really busy to me. But that could be my own perspective, right?
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully we did well. Hopefully we outdid our numbers, and hopefully it only gets bigger and bigger.
All right, what's this gonna trip me up? But what I did notice, regardless of if the numbers were up and down, I did notice there was a lot more evident outpouring. Oh. Last sounds of summer.
You can tell how big
his
engine is.
So regardless of the numbers, what I did notice a lot myself personally was that the audiences were very, very vocal about how much they appreciated the performances this year.
Yes.
Yeah.
Definitely. I noticed that too. And hopefully that's going to be a trend, is seeing that pattern of people sharing on Facebook and on Twitter what shows they're seeing, you know, using the hashtags to get our attention, because if you don't use the hashtags, I won't see it. You have to either at Fundy Fringe Fest or use hashtag Fundy Fringe for me to even know that you've tweeted or said something about us.
And hand in hand with that, it was really impressive to see what I talked about with Dead Sheep Scrolls earlier, was that you really now have an amazing sense of community as this art being community. You know?
Yeah, exactly, and hopefully that's something that will continue for us as a trend as well, that the community will continue to grow with us and embrace us more, and we'll develop more partners and more links to other events in the community and go forward from there.
Great. And any last words on how to maybe encourage local performers to come out and Fringe next year? Apply?
To apply to be a part of the lineup?
Yeah.
Well, follow us on Facebook and Twitter, because that's where we're going to post it. Our application will be released the first Monday of January, which is our tradition anyways. So keep your eyes peeled for that. It's $25 to apply, so that's not too bad, I don't think. And whatever they're thinking of creating, bring it to the table, because Fringe is the mode to do it with. It doesn't matter if it's a polished and finalized by refined product, or if it's something you're just trying out, see if it sticks to the wall.
Great, it's gonna be welcome. Well, here we are, we'll get Watson in, and once again, Sarah, thank you for everything. Congratulations on another year accomplished, and see you next year.
Thank you, Tim, for being our steadfast radio host and steadfast performer and steadfast Fringe fan and supporter.
Well, I'm gonna definitely sleep for a week after this. Donovan Jackson, thank you again, and Watson, you were a good dog. So there you have it. Connect with the Fundy Fringe Festival online and get your application in for next year's season. You are listening to F4 Fringe Power Aftermath. Aftermath. There we go.
St. John's Alternative Radio, local 107.3 FM.
This is Sarah Rankin, your friendly Fundy Fringe Festival director, and you're listening to Local 107.3.
The best of the fest. Three local favorite plays from the 2016 Fundy Fringe Festival are being showcased again tomorrow. That's Tuesday, August 30th. $20 gets you in to see all three shows. Come Fly With Me, The Velvet Undergrad, and of course, Hamilton MacKenzie, the musical. If you missed them before, don't miss them now. In the studio, we have with us the other half of Hamilton MacKenzie, the musical, Keith Dickson. Okay. Was that you?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right.
Edit again.
No, that's all right.
I see, with this one, when it's my parents, it's you can't just ignore it.
Yeah, go for it.
You can. Because, oh, I'm not going to pick up. That takes too long. She's the only one to talk to Iris anyway that could care less about me now. Like, I'm just... I'm just the gateway. Like, if she could answer the phone without me,
yeah,
they wouldn't even need to, like...
Oh, okay, yeah, okay. No, I don't have that problem. I just have a problem with my mother. When I call my mother once every 6 months, it's like I get talked to about people I don't know. And
yeah, like, so that's good. We thought it was a regional thing. We were just talking with people during the Fringe of, you know, oh no, I bumped into a buddy of mine. I was like, oh, old so-and-so.
Yeah.
Passed away. And like, oh,
so I have no idea who they are.
Yeah.
You know Richard's cousin?
Yeah.
His ex-wife used to run that shop down there, and there used to be this guy that come in all the time. Now, he was a bit of a codger and a bit of a wank, but, you know, he was related to... And I'm like, oh, my God.
And it just keeps,
I just want to ask for money and hang up. Yeah. You know, hurry up.
No, but they just keep trying to connect. They're like... Oh, don't you know Jim? You went to school with Jim, and I'm like, maybe. I don't know. I don't care. Yeah.
Well, Keith Dickson is here with us in the studio today, the other half of Hamilton MacKenzie.
Mm.
And I apologize, Keith, about the seating arrangements. If you just want to sit on the edge of the bed frame here, but just try not to fall back too much.
Yeah, I thought we were supposed to have, you know, the old motion in the ocean, but.
Keith, knowing you were coming, I was hoping that there would be some motion.
In the ocean? Yeah, but
no, there's...
I'm just on this hard wooden frame.
Yeah, the membrane or whatever you call that Philly app baggy thing, we're just going to ignore that. We'll just sit down, and if your sitting bones get sore, just, you know, feel free to stretch your legs. Yeah. Right. So, Keith, Hamilton MacKenzie, congratulations. I heard a lot of good things about it.
Yeah, it seemed to go well.
Yeah? You feel that?
Yeah.
I'm just confirming. I mean, these could be complete lies I heard in the street.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's fun. There's definitely moments when you can feel the hip-hop vibe flow through, if you would. But, I think the audience enjoyed it. The only show that I felt slightly awkward about is I believe Scott had some elderly aunts and uncle in the audience. And they were, like, dead center. And for most of my rap scenes, I'm dead center and just blasting whoever is standing right in front of me, and I'm sure I blasted them really bad. So, like, at least I know they heard it.
Yeah,
like,
of course.
I don't know how they felt about it.
But. Now, was this the night that you rapped about toothpaste?
No, that was, I think they were there for hide and seek. So I think they were the hide and seek champion. And one of my rhymes was "Hup Pow Surprise," and they like pop out, but it was right in their face. So I'm sure they enjoyed that. They got a load of my spittle. Yep.
I remember a time when I was actually you were in that production as well. We're doing Taming of the Shrew.
No, I
we were doing Shakespeare in the Parking Lot.
Yes, of course. Yeah.
And I found you know, because as Scott is apt to direct at, it was very clown, very physical. So the opening of that second number, when we're all coming out and we've got the mops and introducing the second act, I start doing something very provocative with my dance moves in front of a gentleman at the corner of the stage, which, you know, is fully endorsed by Scott. And little did I know, it was his dad. And
also, it was Byron. Nice.
And I was physically removed from his view.
Did he just, like, push you to the side?
He just grabbed me and threw me to the side. That's Get out of my way!
That's pretty good, because I don't know. I don't know if he says too much that often, so it's good.
I got a response. That's awesome. No, I was quite thrilled to know that I moved someone as much as they moved me physically.
And it's good. Now our shows are to the point we don't really include the audience, because we've felt over the years they don't really want to be included. Other than maybe one suggestion or so, but we kind of keep that to a minimum so that we don't terrify anyone. Because people get horrified if they think they have to stand up in front of someone.
Especially with an improv show.
Yeah, well, because I don't know. I don't know if it's the games version they see on TV that people get pulled up or interviewed like in front of everyone that they start to panic, but yeah, we've kind of cut that out some time ago.
This is your third show in the Fringe?
Yeah, you know what the funny thing is? I was listening to your previous episode with Scott, and he said the third, and I was like, man, really? Like, I had to go look back, but I did legitimately forget that the Improv Corps itself, the whole group, did one in the first year. I completely forgot about that for some reason.
And because that was, you did the one with Neil Bonner in
the second year.
That was the second year,
yeah, and I didn't do anything last year, but... Yeah, for some reason I thought it was I did Neil's, and then I did this year. I was like, I don't think I did anything first year, but we had the full group, that's why.
So, as a local, I mean, what would you say to other performers that are out there, or would-be performers, or I don't want to use it as a derogatory term, but yeah. Like wannabe performers.
Yeah.
What would you recommend to get them to, you know, take that plunge and apply?
It's what I've always said was I think anybody can really do it. It's if you have a passion project, if you have something that you know you've always wanted to do, but whether you're a local theater company, maybe you don't have a local theater company. But there's something that you've always wanted to test out, I think Fringe is a perfect opportunity for it, because really, Fringe is designed that anything goes. Over the 4 years, we've seen tons of variations of shows, and there's no reason why not to try it out. Probably the only suggestion is it'd be in your benefit if you can find someone to watch your show, and maybe give an outside view of it before bringing it to Fringe. But otherwise, I mean, I think anybody can put forth whatever their passion is, whatever it is. I mean, this year, look, we've seen magic acts, a dance show, obviously written theatrical pieces, a number of one-person shows, as well as a handful of musicals. So really, it kind of ranges the spectrum of what you want to do.
Yeah, because, I mean, if you're already a touring Fringe artist, I mean, you don't really need that much convincing to try it yourself. But you know, if you're a local and you're sitting and you're like, hey, you know, I could do that, but you don't think you're included, but it's pretty open. So
yeah.
does that mean you might have your own one person show in the future?
Yeah, possibly. Yeah, probably at some point. I think everybody. I just don't know if I have enough. I don't know if I have enough angst to put out a one person show.
Why don't you bring Leslie?
I know. Well, yeah. I thought all the time of writing like a relationship show with my wife, just because. You know, it'd be fun to do. It'd be easy to rehearse.
Oh yeah, yeah. No babysitter needed.
No, it could bring it all. It could bring everything to a grinding halt. But you know, that's the risk of theater.
That's true. You know, you're either going to have a successful show or you're going to get divorced.
Yeah, or terrible. Yeah, you're going to ruin my marriage.
Win-win.
I mean, it depends how much money we make during the Fringe, right? Can I cover the divorce? If not,
probably not. No, yeah. No, we'll just stay for the kid.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's only like 13, 16 more years. It's fine.
All due respect to Leslie.
Oh, yeah. She knows. She's well aware.
I'm just as scared of her as you are, Keith. So, congratulations on being selected for the Best of the Fringe.
Yeah, that's always a treat.
Some of the best local shows that were in the 2016 lineup are being remounted this Tuesday, tomorrow, as today will be.
Yeah.
Today will be a Monday. So, Hamilton MacKenzie, of course, is yours with Scott, and you're looking forward to that?
Of course, yeah. It's one of those things, whenever you're done a show, you immediately go, oh, I can forget all of this, like all the music, whatever. So now I have to, like, listen to it a little again. But, no, I always enjoy doing the shows with Scott. And, you know, it's like any show, once you get to the end of your run, that's kind of when you're finding your rhythm to the show, so... You know, you almost wish you could do a little bit more, but...
So this is the prime time to see your show.
I think so, yeah. We've hashed out both the relatively blue material, and obviously we did a super kids-friendly show on Sunday, and they all went over well. Even our would-be blue show on Saturday night, where the theme was he was a famous male prostitute, it still never delved into, you know, massive amounts of cursing. Even some of the sexual references are still very tame, considering...
Yeah, because I'm not very aware... I mean, I don't know you or Scott as being... very cursive or sexual.
Well, oh, I would look like I'm sexual, but no, like I think that's part of it too. When it's the style of show, we want to make it as accessible as possible. And so, you know, we don't want to throw anybody off if they, some people just don't like to hear curse words. They just don't. So if that throws them off, I'd rather them be in the audience and hear innuendo or vague references to body parts.
So speaking of being in the audience, have you seen both the other shows that are going to be, because you've got $20 for all three shows?
Yeah, it's great.
I did see
Neil Bonner's The Velvet Undergrad. I didn't get a chance to see Come Fly With Me, but once again, I wanted to see that show, but just by the weird times when their shows were banked with other ones, I didn't get a chance to see it, so this will work out well. I get to see it too.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Okay.
It'll be my second chance seeing Neil's Velvet Undergrad. So,
did you enjoy it?
Yeah, Neil's is great. You know, it was a good mix of both really heavy dramatic material mixed in with, you know, moments of levity, and you could tell he really put his heart into it.
Good, good. Because this is great for me too, because I mean, I was so busy during the Fringe myself that I didn't get to see any of you.
Oh, really?
You know, I didn't get to see Hamilton MacKenzie. I didn't get to see the Velvet Undergrad, and I definitely didn't get to see Come Fly With Me, which I was hoping to do. Now I get the opportunity to see all three. And Christine, now I don't know if this is based on biography or anything like that. I'll have to ask her when I see her, but you're aware that this is homegrown.
She was telling us, yeah, that Christina decided to write this all herself. To stage it herself. She had done, I think, some projects with Tyler, so that's why she probably tagged in Tyler to do the show with her. But, you know, that takes a lot of commitment, a lot of guts to do that. So it's nice to see the show come out. And once again, I'm looking forward to finally seeing it.
So, yeah, so once again, it just shows how accessible and, you know, the Fringe is and, you know, allows you to take those chances without, you know, any judgment.
Exactly.
You know, it's a safe risk.
I think that's the purpose, really, at the heart of the Fringe, is that, you know, if you have something that you want to say, this is kind of the venue to do it. You know, with the application process, you could see all the different varied projects that come through, so you have a real good shot of seeing your piece performed.
Perfect. Well, Keith Dickson, I really appreciate you coming in the studio and talking with us, and I wish you all the best for the rest of the year. I'm looking forward to your show whenever it comes out.
Yeah. Two person. I look forward to your bed being filled with water.
So am I. I really don't know if that's going to happen by the end of this season being our last episode, but at least it's here for next year.
Nice.
Yeah. And, just all the best with Tuesday night.
Thanks, Tim.
Thank you. And that sums it up for F4 Fringe Power Aftermath. Whoops. Aftermath. You have been in bed with Tim Turnell, and we put the show to bed again for another year. You can continue to follow us online through social media, then you'll be able to keep in touch not only with Fringe Power, but also things like my other web series. You can keep in contact with us during the rest of the year through social media. Go to Facebook and look up Fringe Power, or Theater Narcissus 12, or our new web series that we have coming out very, very, very soon, Dulce on a Bench, and hashtag UberTim events which support the Canadian independent film industry. You can also go to Twitter at Tim Turnell. I'd like to thank all my guests this season, as well as all the Fundy Fringe Festival folks that participated this year and helped make this festival happen. I'd like to thank you, my listeners, and, of course, all my musical guests. I'd like to thank my oversight, Chad, and Local 107.3 FM for putting up with me for another year. Now, we leave you with our next musical guest, whom I've been chasing around the internet for a number of years now as we both try to beat each other out for that Tim Turnell brand handle on social media. My very long-distant cousin, and you can check out more of his work on YouTube and SoundCloud. Folks, I've always wanted to say this. New music from Tim Turnell. This is Charlie. Thanks for listening, everybody. You are all great in bed.